Tonight on Four Star Playhouse, Singer presents Dick Powell in The Witness.
Yeah, Michael Donegan. He didn't show up again. It's the fourth straight day and the judge is fit to be tied. Donegan's client hasn't got a chance, so he's stalling. I don't know what that'll get him, except a contempt citation. Well, I'll call the city desk if there's any changes.
This court is not a gymnasium for the acrobatics of Michael Donegan, nor the city of New York an instrument upon which he can practice his own brand of courtroom tactics.
Where is he, Mr. Bedeker?
If Your Honor, please.
Where is he, Mr. Bedeker? Why isn't he here?
Well, Mr. Donegan is desperately trying to locate the key witness for the defense. In the interest of justice, Your Honor.
Your Honor, Mr. Donegan's been desperately trying for the past 4 days to locate that witness. I submit this farce has gone far enough. This is another of Donegan's tricks to delay trial. It's a clear case of contempt.
I'll handle this, Mr. District Attorney. Mr. Bedeker.
Yes, sir?
I will recess until tomorrow morning. But trial will proceed at that time, whether or not Mr. Donegan is present.
Well, Your Honor, Mr. Donegan prepared the defense. No one else is equipped.
Then he'd better be here, eh, Mr. Bedeker? Mr. Donegan may be busy somewhere else today, but tomorrow he's going to be busy in this courtroom.
Oh, I'll have a T-bone steak, rare on the inside, charred on the outside. What's the matter?
Mr. Doniger, don't you got an imagination? Steak. One at a time, steak. Look, I'm going to give you a break. I'm going to bring you out a nice plate of Greek lamb givetchi. I made with my little hands.
Well, that's the main reason I want a T-bone steak and some O'Brien potatoes.
Okay, is your stomach? Oh, be our guest.
Hello, Mr. Donegan.
Hi, Philip. Had your lunch?
Yes, sir.
All right, you have a cup of coffee and a slice of mixed apple pie.
Oh, apple pie.
I'll have some myself, too.
Two apple pie.
How'd it go, Philip?
Mr. Donegan, I can't begin to describe how angry the judge was.
Try the oblique approach?
Yes, sir. I thought he was going to have a stroke.
Well, that's oblique enough.
Mr. Donegan, what are we going to do?
Philip, now you're doing wonderfully. You know, someday I expect to see the name Philip Bedeker III in gold letters on our door.
Well, that's very gratifying, sir. But tomorrow...
Tomorrow? Tomorrow and tomorrow, we're going to keep on getting delays.
Yes, but...
Philip, we're protecting our client, aren't we?
Yes, sir. I know he doesn't stand a chance unless we find this Alice Blair.
But... And we've got to have time to find her.
But we're not finding her. We're no closer to finding her than we were 3 weeks ago. Mr. Donegan... What are we going to do tomorrow morning?
Oh, right at the moment, Philip. I haven't got the slightest idea. Aren't you going to wait for your apple pie?
No, sir. I've got a touch of heartburn.
But I ordered it.
I'll eat it. Hey, Philip, I saw your act in court this morning. You're improving with experience.
Hello, Mr. Peterson. I'll be at the office if you want me.
All right, Philip. Pete?
Hi. Said you wanted to see me, Mike. It's not much of a place for business, but I know you're pretty busy.
Well, I got your bill.
Outrageous, isn't it? I am sorry about it, though, Mike, but it costs a lot of money to have six top operators moving around. You know that.
Because the price is the result.
Yeah, there aren't any. You know, Mike, if anybody but you asked me to make this search, I'd say they're out of their minds.
Nothing?
Nothing that hasn't led us up a blind alley.
Like what?
Well, like one of the boys got onto a girl that he thinks might have known a girl by the name of Alice. Let's see. 5'3", 114 pounds, blonde. She's a model. But that's all we know about her, except that she's been dining here at Nick's almost every day lately. Well, she isn't here now.
My, you've changed.
Blonde, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Well, Alice is a brunette.
If there is an Alice Blair, this one might have been her roommate.
What do you think, Pete?
I think you're wasting your money with me. You got us chasing the Phantom. There isn't any Alice Blair.
My client says that.
I don't care what your client says. I still think she doesn't exist outside his imagination. No Alice Blair ever handed over any $6,500 to him.
Well, looks as if I'll have to have a little heart-to-heart talk with my client.
What's wrong, Mr. Donegan?
Well, you lied to me.
For 3 weeks, I've had 6 detectives combing this whole town for that mythical woman of yours.
Well, she's a brunette with blue eyes, the kind of figure you could...
Yeah, I know. What did you do with the money, Frank?
I told you.
Well, she didn't give it to you. You pulled that payroll robbery and shot the guard yourself.
But she did give it to me. She gave it to me the first night I met her.
Oh, that's something you didn't tell me.
It's because I didn't think you'd believe me.
A woman you meet the first night gives you $6,500.
Well, you see, we went to my apartment and we played cards.
Oh, well, that explains everything.
You know how it is. You know how it is when you play for fun? You make up all kinds of stakes. Well, when she pulled out all these new 10s and 20s, Mr. Donegan, I didn't want to touch that money. She asked me to hold on to it for a while anyway. For safekeeping, she says.
You couldn't make up a story like that.
And then, well, I kept it around the apartment for a while. And I got kind of worried about all that money laying around, so I took it down to the bank.
You know how much money was in that payroll?
I think the paper said $150,000.
Mm. Over. What do you think happened to the rest of the money?
I don't know. Honest, I don't know.
You really don't? You know what I think? I think Alice Blair is working with the fellow who pulled the robbery. I think they gave you the money to see if it was hot. See if you could pass it. If you tried to pass it and got caught, you'd burn for it. If it wasn't hot, well, Alice and this guy would be safe for the rest of the payroll.
No, Mr. Donegan, Alice isn't like that. She's the most wonderful girl I've ever known. She's considerate, gentle, and sweet. She's the kind of a girl that makes you think you're the biggest and best man in the world.
Oh, now I know you made her up. Who ever heard of a woman like that?
All I know is if you find her, I know she'll tell the truth.
Well, all I know is that if I don't, it's my reputation and your life. This is a murder charge. Oh, well, we'll think of something. Hey, guard! Get me out of this fire trap.
Yeah, that's right. Looks like another delay. Donegan didn't show up again. This'll make the 5th day in a row. Hey, Marty, I gotta go. Court's in session. Yeah, I'll call you back.
Oh, Philip, yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, Philip, I think you're doing brilliantly. No, I'm not coming back to the office this afternoon. For many reasons. One of which is I'm having a tea with a lovely lady. Is that all, Philip? Oh, yes, I am quite busy. Well, goodbye, Philip. Bet you'd never get back. Out at Gibson's, do you mind?
Wonderful. And thank you, Michael.
For what, the Gibson's?
No, for calling me a lovely lady.
Well, I was always taught in law school that the defendant is innocent until proved guilty.
I'm afraid even you would have trouble proving me innocent, Counselor.
I think the one last night was prettier.
Take the phone.
Take the phone.
To the rest of the day.
All the things for you, I wish for myself. Michael, it's so elegant, smart.
What's more, it's comfy. Try this chair. Very comfortable. Drink?
Love one.
Music?
Why not?
Forgive this key. I've got an alcoholic butler.
What an exciting world you live in.
Well, it has its moments.
Now?
Now's one of the moments.
Thank you.
You know, it's been a very relaxing day.
For me too, Michael.
Strange, too. It seems like I've known you a long, long time.
That's your own calmness inside. Your confidence. Must be a great comfort to your client.
Well, it isn't very comforting to the client I'm representing right now.
The Frank Dana case.
Yes.
But you're so clever about these things, Mike. You'll win the case. You always do.
If I find Alice Blair. If I find her, I win. If I don't, I lose. And my client loses, too.
Let me do it, Michael. Go on. Relax.
Don't mind if I do, but I'm on my feet all day.
You're being very gentle with me. Introducing yourself to me. Taking me to dinner. Why, Michael?
Because you wanted me to. You wanted to find out all you could about Frank Dana.
How did you know, Michael?
Well, the one crumb of evidence I got from six detectives working 3 weeks was that you might be a friend of Alice Blair.
I see.
I guess I'm just lucky. The delays I've been getting in the trial are coming to an end. Now you come along. I'm just lucky.
I wish I could help, Michael.
You're the only one who can. And if you don't, an innocent man will go to the chair.
No, you won't let him, Mike. You'll figure a way. Michael, Alice Blair can't get involved.
I like you like this. Very nice. Charming, gracious. How did Frank Dana put it? He said she's the kind of girl who'll make you think you're the biggest and best man in the world. Considerate, gentle. I can't imagine you looking any better as a brunette with those blue eyes.
Mike.
He's in trouble, Alice.
Mike, I can't tell you why, but I just can't.
Why did you give him the money?
No.
I understand you're a pretty bad card player.
It was just a way. I wanted Frank to put it in a safe place.
It wasn't very safe.
All right. What do I have to do, Mike?
Tell the jury you gave him the money.
That's all? Not where I got it?
He's on trial. You're not.
All right, Mike.
Thank you, Alice.
With a handkerchief masking his face, stole a payroll in excess of $150,000. And with deliberate intent, did shoot Harold Toomey, one of the two guards, to death with the same gun. The state will prove that Frank Dana attempted to pass some of that payroll money, and in so doing, was apprehended. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, do not be swerved from bringing in the only just verdict you can reach. Guilty of murder in the first degree.
Oh, looks as if he's finally running down.
Well, sir? Since it was me and my late partner he was holding up, I guess I was pretty close, but when I started to pull my gun and start shooting, why, he wasn't so close anymore. And he kept getting further and further away each shot I took. That fellow over there, he fits what I saw. Only one thing, though. Can't understand why I missed hitting him. I'm a good shot.
That's all, thank you. Cross-examine?
No questions. Prior to July 12th, Frank Dana's average balance in our bank was exactly $31.06. On that date, he made a cash deposit of $6,500 in new 10s and 20s. I was surprised at the amount, and I checked the serial numbers. It was part of the cash stolen in the armored car robbery, all right.
Thank you. Your witness?
Nothing.
Well, how can you just sit there and let the district attorney get away with all those innuendos?
Oh, remember your heartburn, Philip.
Yes, sir, but...
Philip, the DA's on our side. It's as though he knew exactly what we planned to do and was anxious to help set it up properly. Now watch, he's going to...
Please call the defendant, Frank Dana, to the stand.
See?
All through these long weeks, Mr. Dana, you've repeated that Alice Blair gave you the money. And no such woman exists. The police have failed to find any evidence of her.
But she did give it to me.
You offer no other explanation in this courtroom now for having the money in your possession?
No, sir.
That's all. The prosecution rests.
No questions, Your Honor. The witness may return to his seat.
Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to delay this painful trial any more than necessary. Now, the case for the prosecution rests entirely on circumstantial evidence. The fact that Frank Dana had in his possession $6,500, which was part of a robbery murder. But what about the balance of the money? A little matter of approximately $145,000. Well, Frank Dana swore on oath that a woman named Alice Blair gave him the $6,500.
Now, the district attorney says that Alice Blair doesn't exist. I now call Alice Blair to the stand. Alice Blair. You take the stand, please, Miss Blair.
The courtroom will settle down.
Push your left hand on the Bible, please. You solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
State your name, please.
Alice Blair.
Be seated, Miss Blair. Miss Blair, District Attorney Mahaffey.
Would you please tell the court... I think you'd better use the microphone there. Alice, would you please tell the court, do you know Frank Dana?
Yes.
Did you give him $6,500 in new $10 and $20 bills?
Yes.
Did Frank know where the bills came from?
No. No, he didn't.
Thank you.
Your witness, Patrick.
Your Honor, the prosecution requests a recess. This new element has changed the entire complexion of this case.
Prosecution's request seems reasonable. If defense counsel agrees, I will declare...
No, sir. Your Honor, this trial has been delayed too many times already. There's no doubt the complexion of the case has changed, but that isn't an excuse for recess. I respectfully submit that although the prosecution didn't find Alice Blair, they were told repeatedly of her existence by the defendant.
Trial will proceed.
Miss Blair, where did you get these?
Object, Your Honor.
The witness is not on trial.
Sustained.
How long have you known the defendant?
Object, Your Honor. Irrelevant and immaterial.
Your Honor, I wish to establish the relationship between the witness and the defendant to determine whether collusion is...
That seems relevant and material. Objection overruled. Continue.
Answer the question, please. How long have you known Frank Dana?
About 3 months.
Have you seen him often?
Yes.
Very often?
Object, Your Honor.
What do you mean by very often, Mr. District Attorney?
I mean simply, is she in love with him?
Object, Your Honor. The line of questioning of the prosecution is leading and intended to form a conclusion in the minds of the jury.
I don't think so. Overruled. Answer the question, Miss Blair.
Am I in love with Frank? Yes, I am.
Now, being in love with him, naturally you'd want to help him in any way you could.
Object, Your Honor.
Sustain, strike the question.
Ever think of getting married to Frank Dana, Miss Blair?
I...
Answer the question, please.
I object, Your Honor. I object to the whole line of cross-examination and repeat, the witness is not on trial.
I think prosecution's line of question is eminently within bounds. Answer the question, Miss Blair.
Did I ever think of marrying Frank? Yes. Yes, I did.
Are you married to him? Are you, Miss Blair? Or is it Mrs. Frank Dana?
No, I'm not married to him.
But you thought of it?
Yes.
Are you engaged to him?
Well...
Engaged to be married?
Yes, I am.
When had you planned on getting married to Frank Dana?
We were to be married...
Until this trial came up and that sort of got in the way of it, is that right?
That's right.
As his prospective wife, didn't you think it would be a good idea to provide Frank Dana with an alibi? Wouldn't you say you gave him the money if you thought it would help your husband?
I'm not married to...
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I submit witness testimony is worthless.
Your Honor, neither the witness nor my client informed me they were engaged to be married. In view of this, rather unexpected situation here that exists, I will accede to the state's desire for a recess.
Oh, no, you don't. What sauce for the goose, Donegan?
Are you requesting a recess, Mr. Donegan?
Oh, no, Your Honor, I guess not. We'll just see how this thing winds up here.
Proceed, Mr. District Attorney.
No more questions, Your Honor.
Redirect, Mr. Donegan?
Yes, Your Honor. Now, Alice, if you'd known the money was from the robbery murder, you wouldn't have given it to Frank, would you?
No.
Well, why did you give it to him?
I had an idea there might be something wrong. I just asked Frank to put it in a safe place. I wanted time to find out about it.
Who gave it to you?
since you don't want to tell me who gave it to you, even though Frank's freedom is at stake, it follows it must have been someone you're very fond of, some member of your family, or somebody you're in love with. Alice, are your parents living?
My mother.
Where is she living?
In Salt Lake City.
How many members in your family?
Just the three of us.
Yourself, your mother, and a sister?
No.
A brother. So it is a brother. Younger brother?
Yes.
And he gave you the money, didn't he? Alice, don't you realize he gave you the money to see if it could be passed? He used you. Why do you keep looking at the spectators? Is it possible that he's here to see how his trial is coming on? He is in the courtroom, isn't he?
No. No, he isn't.
Your Honor, I ask the court to bear with me for a moment. I think we can clear this case up right now. May I ask that every man in that section of the courtroom between the ages of 17 and 27 pass before the witness?
Your Honor, must we be subjected to another of the great Michael Donegan's theatrical performances?
Seems to me everything Mr. Donegan has said is logical. Aren't you anxious to get at the truth of this matter?
Yes, of course, Your Honor, but...
Overruled. I direct the bailiff to assist defense counsel.
All right, sir. All right, sir. All right, sir. Look at him, Alice. Your Honor, may I request that this young man be sworn in?
Permission granted. Witness may be excused.
You can sit down, Alice. Place your left hand on the Bible. You solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
State your name. Your name?
All right, I'm Tom Blair.
Sit down, Tom Blair. Alice is your sister, isn't that right, Tom?
So what? Your Honor, I know I must sound like a broken record, but if we could just have a recess...
All right, Tom, you gave your sister $6,500, is that true? Don't you know that you're making Alice liable as an accessory?
That's what you say.
What did you do with the rest of the money, Tom?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Now, Tom.
Hey, let go of me.
Is it necessary to hold the witness while you question him, Mr. Donegan?
Oh, I'm sorry, Your Honor. Tom, what did you do with the rest of the money?
I told you, I don't know what you're talking about.
Look, Tom.
Hey, what is this?
I don't think he'll fly away, Mr. Donegan.
Well, I'm sorry, Your Honor. My emotions ran away with me. Stand up, Tom. Stand up! You know, you're a pretty well-developed young man. Nice shoulders, nice chest.
No.
Take off your coat.
No.
I think I know what Mr. Donegan's getting at. Take off your coat, young man.
It won't be necessary, Your Honor. Yeah.
Oh!
Now, what could cause a bulge like that under your shirt? Maybe a bandage? Did you get yourself hurt, Tom? Maybe from a bullet? The guard couldn't understand how he missed you at such a close range. He didn't miss you, did he, huh?
All right. All right. I did it.
Your Honor, defense rests.
Mr. Donegan, thank you very much.
All right, Frank.
I'm sorry I didn't tell the whole truth.
Well, that's understandable. You didn't know all the facts.
Because she ran away, I guess I wanted you to find her more than anything else.
You know, I think you two kids should celebrate. I know a nice place. Nick's.
I've got a place all picked up.
Oh, you have?
Goodbye, and thank you.
Bye.
Yeah. Ah, it's a nice boy. Beautiful girl.
It's too bad about her brother.
Yeah, he's really in trouble. He's going to need a good attorney.
Mr. Donegan, certainly you're not considering...
Philip, you know the accused is always entitled to the best of defense. Even if he is guilty, there may be mitigating circumstances. Missing witnesses.
Oh, Mr. Donegan.
Shall we explore over a couple of steaks at Nick's?
Mr. Donegan...
Oh, relax, Philip. He hasn't asked me. Did I give you a little heartburn there for a minute?
Yes, Mr. Donegan.
Well, don't worry. I got a little myself.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have been guests of the Singer Sewing Machine Company this evening. We hope you enjoyed the play. Next week, our star in the 4-star Playhouse will be David Niven. Please be with us. Good night.